Good morning, everyone. I invite you to stand and sing with us.
Well, good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you here this morning to worship together as a church family here in the sanctuary and also in the all-purpose building. So as far as announcements, Jean said she has one. So if you want to come up, Jean, I'll let you go first.
Okay. So we're coming to the end of another year here, and I just thought I would mention our envelope system that we have. If you've been using it already in the past, you'll probably find your new envelopes for next year in your mailboxes. If you have not used them and you're interested in using them, now is the time to do that and let us know. You can start them any time, but it's really nice to start them at the beginning of the year. It's one nice thing that you can, you'll get, at the end of the year, you'll get a copy of all of your weekly offerings, everything you put in, your donations, and then you'll have that for your taxes. We've noticed, we have about 28 of the families here that have been using that over the past. It's starting to dwindle off a little bit. We have numbers that are out but aren't being used. If you have one of those numbers and you're not planning on using it, a lot of people are starting to do their offerings through PayPal, so they probably don't need to use those envelopes anymore. So if you have those numbers and you're not planning on using them, get in touch with me so we can give that number to someone else. But if you're thinking that you'd like to do that, get in touch with me, and I'll make sure you'll get some boxes there. Marilyn Sensnick usually is the one that handles that, but they aren't around a lot. They're out in the truck a lot. So I'm the contact person now. If you don't know, I'm Jean Hest, and I'm the treasurer for the church. So I'm the one you have to call. Any questions? Get in touch with me.
Okay. One other announcement. Kevin Baker wanted me to announce that he will be in the back of the church as well with the raffle tickets for the fundraiser for Devin Weaver. So if you have not bought a raffle ticket yet, you can do so after church in the back. A few other announcements. Most of them are listed here in the bulletin. There will be volleyball here at the gym tonight at 6 o'clock, so you're more than welcome to come and join, play volleyball. There's a couple other small Christmas parties that are announcements in here as well. I'll just let you look through your bulletin to figure out which group you're a part of, and then figure out the dates and stuff, which is all in there. So for a small devotion here this morning, as we prepare our hearts for worship, I've been thinking a lot about Jesus when he left heaven and was born as a baby. And Eddie preached a sermon a couple Sundays ago on the humility of Christ. And I want to read, it's in Philippians 2, verses 5 through 8. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient even to the point of death. You know, Jesus was in heaven. He knew what the glory of heaven is. He knew what it was when he was born. We have not experienced that yet here on earth. But yet he left the glory of heaven to be born as a baby and to experience life here. So that way we have an opportunity through Jesus' blood to experience glory with him in heaven someday. And I was thinking of that as we go into the Advent season and as we go into Christmas time. You know, we celebrate Christmas because of the birth of Christ. There's a lot of other people that, you know, they experience the holidays. They call it the holidays, but it's a time where, even though you may not call it Christmas, but they're Christ is at the heart of all this, of celebrating, and we want to celebrate his birth. But as we think about Christmas, let's think of Jesus, who was God, but he became a baby, took on flesh. What does that mean to you? And if your life, sometimes, you know, you grumble about different things in life. And I appreciated the message that Lester shared last Sunday about grumbling and complaining. So listen to that message, and then listen to the message that Eddie preached on Christ's humility. And ask God to speak to your heart. So at this time, we're going to do the Advent reading. So Laura and Alyssa. So for those of you who may not know exactly who we are Mike and Laura Swory, and I am one of the elders on the pastoral team. And our oldest daughter, Hope, could not be here today because she's at a SALT training, which is a servant leadership training in Alaska. So she's in Alaska where it's cold. So she's not here with us today, but Alyssa is here with us, and Kendrick as well. So, and all went to be registered, each to his own town.
And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. Luke 2, verses 3 through 7. And there in the stable, amongst the chickens and the donkeys and the cows, in the quiet of the night, God gave his wonderful gift. The baby that would change the world was born, his baby son.
Do you remember the promise we talked about last week? God's promise to send a rescuer, his promise to send Jesus. Well, Jesus came just like God said he would. After thousands of years of waiting, on an ordinary night, Jesus came. God gave his people hints and clues about how Jesus would come. He told them that Jesus would come from Bethlehem, be a ruler and a bring peace. Many expected a soldier. Some expected a politician. No one expected a baby, but that's how Jesus came.
If you had been an Israelite, how would you have expected the promised Savior to come? Mary and Joseph lived in a town called Nazareth. One day, the king gave an order that everyone was to go back to their hometown to be counted for something called a census. Mary and Joseph traveled a long way to the town of Bethlehem, where Joseph's family was from. When they got to Bethlehem, the town was full of other travelers, and there was nowhere for Mary and Joseph to stay. So they found a stable to sleep in. While they were there, the time came for Mary to have her baby, and Jesus, the Savior, was born. Jesus, the King of Heaven, left his perfect home to be born as a baby to a young man and woman. He became fragile and helpless. His room that night was a stable, dirty and smelly and full of noisy animals. His bed was not kingly or luxurious. It was a feed box that animals ate out of. Mary had to wipe rotten food out of the manger and cover it with pokey straw before she laid her tiny baby in it.
Is a stable where you would expect the Savior to be born? Why do you think God decided for his only one and his only son to be born there? Everything that happened that night was exactly what God had planned and promised. Jesus came just like God said he would. God saw that we needed to be rescued from sin. He cared about us in our need, and he acted. He sent Jesus. The events of that night in that stable in the little town of Bethlehem would change the world forever. Ushers, if you want to come forward, and then we'll pray for the service. And just another special announcement, Eddie's going to come up after worship, and he has a special announcement to make then as well. Let's pray. Father, we just pause before you. We want to thank you for your son, Jesus, the one who took on flesh, so that way he gave his life for us here, that we have a hope, and our hope and trust is in you. We just thank you that everything you do in our lives has a purpose and a plan designed and created by you. Thank you for this body. And we just ask that you would be here this morning as we worship and we lift you up, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you continue to soften our hearts and work in our lives so that you can mold us into who we are and who you have created us to be. And we just ask that you would take the blessings that you have given us. May we give them back to you to bless others that are in need. We give you this service in Jesus' name. Amen.
God, you entered in and became one of us. Sing alleluia, sing alleluia, sing alleluia for the things he has done. Come and adore him, bow down before him, sing could make every king bow down. Who else can whisper and darkness tremble? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, for our holy God. Come and worship the holy God. What other glory consumes like fire? What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. else could rescue me from my failing? Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God. Only a holy God.
Good morning, everyone. Great to see you all here this morning. And I know Mike said that I would be coming up to do a special announcement. And, you know, as many of you know, next Sunday, I will be installed as the next lead pastor here. And with that change, Lester will then be stepping down. He's finishing up on staff through the end of the year. But we came together as a church family. We wanted to honor them. And I just want to commend you for your generosity. We wanted to be able to present them with a loved gift that they can use for whatever they want. We're going to encourage you to take a trip together. Your faithful service here has been incredible. And I'm sad that I've only been here for a year and a half of it. And so I'd love for both of you, instead of just Lester, before we get the word today, for both of you to come to the front so that I could hand you the gift, that we could give them a big applause, and also that I could pray over them as they transition as well. And I'll also be praying for the children and Children's Church then. So if you guys, both Lester and Artis, would come up. I'll give that to you, and we'll pray. Father, we are so grateful, so grateful for Lester and Artis, for their faithful service to bring the word, to care and pastor this church, the people within it. God, I've been blessed immensely by them, and I know so many who have. Father, I pray for them in this time of transition. Father, that you would just bring an immense blessing and an opportunity for them to feel your presence, to experience your joy over them. Father, I pray that they would continue to take a faithful service, maybe not in a position or role, maybe not a title, but God, they have so much to offer. And we're so grateful that they are going to continue to be a part of our church, to be a part of our family. Father, I pray again, that you're just, that they would sense how full of passion you are for them and how they have served so well. Father, we also lift up the children today. Father, we pray that as they go, as they get to experience and hear from your word, that you would do a mighty work in them. God, that even at this young age, that they would hear and understand and respond to the gospel of grace that Lester has done so well of preaching here. God, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I might have actually, I have to confess. I have to confess, I haven't been completely honest with you.
Oh. Hey, man. What's going on here?
Well, Eddie, you're a conniver.
It was a team effort, for sure. And part of that conniving is you're not actually preaching today.
Okay. Well, I see Barry here.
Barry's here. Yep, absolutely. Barry and Carol made the trip up. So actually, if you want to sit back down.
I got to say something.
Oh, you can say something. You can, yeah.
Well, I went through all this. I got to at least say something if I can. It's good emotions. And it's not just what's in this envelope. And I just want to say thank you to you as a church, as we've, you know, you were complete strangers 10 years ago, and and you're a blessing. You're a real blessing to just be here among you and to think about remaining here and coming and doing church with you feels good. And I'm not like, you know, just ready to hit the back door after he gets installed next Sunday, feeling like, you know, I'm out of here. No, that's not how I feel. And that's a good feeling. Feels like it's the Church of Jesus Christ, and thank you for your part as well. You know, part of me, you know, feels like, okay, I'm taking a trust step coming here, but you took a big one as well, and there's a lot of blessing in being able to work together, to walk together, and I had a good sermon preparation anyway. Blessings, brother.
Love you.
Love you.
So what is actually going to happen? I'll tell you what's going to happen. We have, it's looking like a real preacher, right? You ask a question, then you answer it.
Okay.
So, and if you didn't know, all of Lester Artis' family, their kids and grandchildren were able to come in, stay. Some of them stayed a whole week here. You had no idea, which was so great. But so we have a couple people lined up to be able to speak,
okay.
And they're going to share a little bit, and then I'm going to close at the end. And so, yeah, again, we want to be a culture where we honor people. It's what we're called to do. And so today we're going to do that for you. So if you want to go ahead and have a seat, and I'll actually instruct who the kind of the order of who's going to be coming up. Okay.
All right.
Hope you enjoy this.
I will, I guess. I don't do a lot of, you know, spotlight stuff.
Here's what's going to happen, though. We have that on video. Your response, your reaction, it's probably going to go out on social media. It's going to be slow motion. It's going to be wonderful.
All right. Well, God knows. So.
Okay. So we're going to have Mike Swory come up. He's going to share. And then after Mike, we have Cindy Erdley, who's going to come up. Elvin is going to come up.
Oh, boy.
Barry will then have a couple words, and then Debbie will be coming up as well, and then I'll come up at the end.
All right.
Okay, sound good?
All right, I trust you.
Okay, well, come on up, Mike.
Wow. I was trying to figure out what to share this morning, and I figured I was just going to share one of my highlights. And like Lester said, 10 years ago, he was a complete stranger coming to this church. And over the last couple years, being an elder, watching Lester in action at a more closer level, I have learned to have a lot of respect for Lester and his insights. and the different things that happen at church and stuff like that. And I've grown to appreciate that. And I know Lester likes agendas and likes things planned out, and this morning it's a little bit different. My highlight was actually taking the class when we were searching for a pastor. I had volunteered as one of the people to take the class to see if pastoring is one of the things that I would want to do. And in that class was out of 1 Timothy, is where we had went through the different qualifications. And if you ever want to do a really deep study on yourself, go through those qualifications, and all of a sudden you realize you come up very short as a human. And I don't have a lot to share, but that was one of my highlights and one of the things that I was thinking about when I was sitting there, was all the children and the grandchildren. Lester, you have a heart for Jesus, and it shows. And it shows through your family, and it shows throughout the church family. And I want to thank you for that. And I know as your responsibilities change, things will change for you. But keep that relationship with Jesus, and keep that as a focus and a central point. Thank you for your time.
Oh, my word, this is fun. I thought, what do I get to say? And then I thought, it's not a roast, Cindy. You can't do that. But if I'm going to be real honest, I've got to bring those kind of things out in this. But I've only known Lester and Artis for less than 2 years. And they have made such an impact on my life. Amazing impact. So one of the things, which those of you in our Sunday school class will know this. So Artis, I just figure the whole church should know this. Right? Yeah, Artis. We're at lunch one day, a group of us ladies from church, and I am talking quite loudly about my political position on something, and I said something along the lines, I'd like to take them out back, and Artis looks at me and she says, Cindy, that could be the spirit of murder. I kid you not. And it just floored me. I was like, oh my word, and I've shared this with so many people. And artists, just so you know, that lots of people are saying that now. That could be the spirit of murder. And she was so true. It's true. I'm not making light of what she said. But what it did for me in just checking myself and what spirits I do allow to just have reign in my life, and I want it to be the Holy Spirit only, which I see just exemplified in artists all the time, except when she's at Walmart. So I won't share that one, artist. I won't share that one. And Pastor Lester, I don't know. I've never felt so comfortable with a pastor in my lifetime, all 59 years of it, to just haul off and punch you. Just come up and prepare and just punch the pastor. But I did. And then that got to be a thing about artists is like, you're punching the pastor. So anyway, but such a brotherly affection I have for you. Thank you so much for that. And then the other thing that artists and Lester both shared with me, again, along those political, which I've heard Preston, is Preston here? Yeah, Preston. I was able to... I'm looking at Jesse and thinking Preston, but Preston's right there. Hear a message that artist gave me of yours, which really spoke to me, but this isn't about you, so we can talk another time. So, but I went to Lester and artist with my questions, and I can always go to them with questions. And they have an answer. You know, I think they just love the Lord so much, and they love me that much, and thank you. But they brought me about to a place where, again, along those political lines, and they're saying, Cindy, don't speak so loudly of your opinion that it would not make it possible to share the gospel with somebody, that you wouldn't be heard. And again, they might not even know that it made such an impression on me, but I changed the way I live because artists brought about my possibly having a spirit of murder. and about my possibly speaking to political opinions so loudly that there would be somebody who may not have an ear to hear the gospel. So thank you both so very much. Thank you. And I'm happy you're still going to be in the church and not out the door. So thank you.
Rick, do you want to add anything to that spirit of murder or not? Well, I consider it an honor to be able to share a few memories and just a little bit of history. 12 years ago, about then, this church was in a bit of a mess when it comes to leadership. We needed help, and we were a bit floundering and a lot of disillusion and a lot of people praying. And we heard about Lester. And a couple of us traveled to meet with Lester at a little restaurant halfway between, 30-minute drive or so. We sat down with Lester, and we didn't know him. So you're taking a huge risk, if you will. But we did know some people that knew them very well, that we got a lot of counsel from, and they highly recommended them and trusted them, and that gave us a lot of confidence in moving forward with Lester and Artis. Over the years, Lester and I have become very close friends. Lester has become somebody that I've learned to trust. Pardon me, I get emotional. It's been a lot of fun. I'm gonna jump around here just a little bit, and I won't take too long, but it has been a lot of fun to see Lester and Artis interact at leadership team meetings. It's been fun to see them when they sort of disagree on an issue, to watch them work that out. It's really actually pretty cool because they have a way of supporting themselves, each other, even when they sort of might disagree about something. And I think it's sort of like parents with kids. Probably there's more discussion goes on at home when they get home that we didn't see, but it's really neat and encouraging to see them. You knew there was not necessarily, there might be a different opinion on something, but they worked it out, and that was really neat. A few things that I've learned from Lester. One of the things he said different times in coaching us as a leadership team is a lot of disagreements in a church and a lot of church splits, and a lot of times when people walk out, it's not really a salvation-based issue. It's just the difference of opinion. And that's really had an impact on me and something I'll never forget, is to make sure that if I have a different opinion than someone else, and it's not a salvation-based issue, suck it up and be able to continue to be friends. Lester always often said, many churches lean one way or another. In other words, there's churches that send people out into the community, and that's their passion and what they really work towards. And then there's also churches that spend a lot of energy to pull people in and to bring them here. And, you know, I think we lean towards a church that really, we want people here, but we want to send them out into the community. And we want them to share the gospel and not just come hear a sermon or not just, yes, that's important, but then what are you going to do with that? You're going to take it out, hopefully, to the community and share it with the people you interact with throughout the week. Who is Lester? Well, one thing I learned, Lester's someone who hates going out for breakfast. Not so much anymore, but there was a while I think Lester felt like going out for breakfast was sort of a waste of time. But we've actually, I hope, I enjoy it, and I think Lester does, and I hear him saying more and more to people, you want to do breakfast or something like that. It's pretty neat. Who is Lester? When he says he'll do something, he does it. I've really learned to appreciate that. When he says something will be done, he does it, and he does it promptly. Lester's very organized, very structured, but he gets things done. Lester is a godly man and a godly character. He's a man of integrity, and he's a man of principles. It's probably the best way to describe what I see in Lester. you might ask as a congregation, why all the fanfare? What's, you know, really? Come on, let's, well, I think this is a great day to celebrate a day of a wonderful life lived in their marriage, lesser known as his marriage, a life lived for Christ, and a man who invested in a lot of people. You know, what an honor it is to be able to see somebody live out their ministry with integrity versus, oh, not another mess up. So I think that's what we're here to celebrate today with Lester Nordis. My dad used to always say, invest in things, or invest in people, not things, because people go, you've made an investment for eternity. And I've seen Lester Nordis do that. They've invested in people. Well, guess what? They get, you know, that will go on for eternity. Almost done. While Lester is very structured, I've found, and has strong convictions, he's also taught me to extend grace to other opinions and other people. And that's been very humbling for me. Because I do tend to have strong opinions, and we joke a lot, you know, sometimes Lester will be like, oh, there comes that depersonality again, you know. But he's been able to challenge me, and I appreciate that because I trust him. And I know he has my back, and I know he has everybody's back here. So, Lester Nordis, we love you. We appreciate you. Thank you.
Well, Lester, it's really an honor to be here with you today and celebrate this day. Across the years, I've learned to greatly appreciate you. I believe it began when we served on the RBC board together. And there have been a lot of things said about Lester here, this organization and that, but one of the things that really stands out to me, I see it in your emails, I see it minutes, team means something very important to you. You're truly a comrade in arms. We're fighting for the gospel, we're fighting for Christ, and I just love the way you come about it in that it doesn't mean that because I'm in charge, Lester saying I'm in charge, I have to get the credit. Team, what can we do? That's a good lesson to learn, to pick up and take from that. So blessings to you as you move from here. I look forward to working with you more in the future in different ways. And blessings again. Thank you.
It is a really big privilege to be here with you all today. Thank you so much for inviting us to be a part of this. And we had the opportunity to be here last weekend. And as I listened to Dad begin his sermon last week, I was overwhelmed by gratefulness to God that I have been able to experience the progression of Dad's ministry, first as a child over the course of many years, and now as an adult. My siblings and I are very honored to be able to share a look back at the progression of his ministry with you today and celebrate the many ways that God has worked through him. Dad's call to the ministry came as a young boy. At age 10, he heard the nudging of the Holy Spirit beginning to open his awareness of what God desired for him. And unsure at first, he did eventually give in to God's leading and followed it wholeheartedly for 45 years. Ordained in Wisconsin in 1977 and newly married in 1978, Dad pursued pastoral work at St. Lawrence Mennonite Church. He attended Eastern Mennonite Seminary during this time too. And in 1982, they moved to Mississippi and began pastoring there at Cornerstone Community Church. I remember when I was small and we lived in Mississippi, and I saw Dad working to build bridges in the community, trying to build relationships and restore unity among Christians of different races was no small job in the racially divided South. And over, I saw Dad listen to people saying, "It can't be done. It just doesn't work that way here. You'll never see racial reconciliation happen in these churches." But Dad believed in the calling to pursue healing for racial tensions. And I saw Dad and Mom begin to live out restoration and reconciliation, pursuing relationships and bringing together groups of multiple races and ethnicities. I also remember the way that Dad and Mom lived this season with a strong trust in God to provide what they needed. With four small children and the pressures of ministry, as well as working construction, there were more times than I even knew about that God provided directly for our family's needs. I remember one time in particular that a check arrived in the mail from someone who had felt the Lord leading them to give to our family, and it arrived just in time to buy groceries in a particularly lean financial time. I remember Mom showing me the check and telling me, "This is why we don't have to worry. God will always provide for us." Even as Dad went back to school and obtained his Master's of Divinity from Moody Bible Institute in 1996, God provided. And Dad continued to serve the church body as pastor there. Jesse remembers Dad going into his study and locking the door so he could work on his sermons. He recalls how Dad would be at Cornerstone leading services on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday nights too. Jesse also says that Dad's pastoral ministry is partially responsible for him getting into computers. Dad got our first computer when he was working on his master's, so he wouldn't have to type everything up on a typewriter, and the word processor could do graphs. It was quite a number of months before he let Jesse take the cover off and look inside, though. Jesse also remembers Dad playing hours of Tetris with him on that very computer. When Dad sensed the call to move from Mississippi to Pennsylvania, he knew that following the voice of Jesus takes trust. Liz remembers Dad calling a family meeting to first broach the topic of moving 1,000 miles across the country. We gathered in the living room, and Mom and Dad shared with us that Dad was feeling God's calling towards something different, possibly a move, to pastor a new congregation. Liz didn't remember all the details surrounding that conversation, but she says she distinctly remembers Dad saying, "Trusting God takes risk. It's like you have to jump, and you're not quite sure where you're going to land, but we can trust God with that part." Dad and Mom's heart's desire has been to be obedient, no matter the risk. And Liz says, "My own trust in God was impacted that day and in the years to come as I saw Dad living out his faith. Dad took the jump in 1998 and followed the call to serve at Mountain View Mennonite Chapel in Belleville, Pennsylvania. We saw Dad faithfully serving the kingdom as he preached, discipled, and led so graciously. When a heart is obedient and willing to risk, the kingdom of God is strengthened." And then God led Dad and Mom to you. I'm so thankful for that. In 2012, they moved to Lewisburg, and Dad was installed here at Buffalo Mennonite Church. Rebecca was in the unique position to experience being a part of the church body here while also living at home. And she and Andrew say they remember Dad as always being welcoming, bringing balance to unique situations, excellent coordinators, always punctual, and full of integrity. They remember Dad and Mom visiting with each family at Buffalo in their first year to hear testimonies and get to know individuals in a personal way. Dad has always emphasized the importance and supremacy of Scripture. And Mom and Dad's caring and selfless acts consistently model Christ's love as instructed in Scripture. Exodus 20:12, "Honor your father and mother." Matthew 7:12, "Do to others as you would have them do to you." John 13:34, "I give you a new commandment. Just as I have loved you, you also must love one another." As children, and now also as adults with children of our own, we have appreciated the way that this affected their marriage and relationship with each other, and how they have shown continued consideration and support for others' needs. This sacrificial care has been especially evident in their care for Grandpa and Grandma, even through Mom's cancer journey and Dad's recurrent pancreatitis attacks. Dad and Mom have served and loved selflessly even in these times, and you, church, you also embraced and loved Dad and Mom in very real ways. As they walked through some difficult years, we as their children are so grateful for the ways that you loved them and supported them. Liz says it well when she says, "When I get asked, 'Where are you from?' I used to hesitate. I never lived in Lewisburg, but my parents now do. I used to separate going to Dad and Mom's church from going home. But you, Buffalo, feel like home. You're so generous, so gracious, so welcoming, so hospitable, so safe. You have loved and supported Dad and Mom so much these past 10 years that we kids have felt the welcome extended to us. You have made going to Dad and Mom's church feel like coming home." And now, after 45 years, Dad is following God's call to the next step of his ministry. In his retirement, I know that we will see these same qualities in Dad: building relational bridges, trusting in God's provision even when there's risk involved, coordinating, welcoming others, and a strong commitment to the Word of God. These are the values that Dad has demonstrated throughout his ministry. Thank you, Dad, for your commitment and your faithfulness.
Thank you. Honor is built upon truth. And all the things that were shared this morning, it's not in an attempt to try to make lesser artists look better than what they are. It's built upon truth. Pastor, I'd like to say thank you for your influence on my life. Thank you for your example, for your wisdom. Our family started coming here in the midst of a very painful season of our lives. I will never forget sitting in your office, sharing our stories, crying and praying together. You walked through something similar, and your counsel and your care was a large part of our continued healing and maturity. So thank you. I'll always remember you saying, often the best pastors are the ones who walk with a limp. That's a profound truth. You are steady and you are dependable. Your example of humble leadership is something that I want to emulate. The way that you have handled this transition has been incredibly honorable. This is not an easy thing. In fact, most pastors who retire are encouraged to leave the congregation that they were pastoring. Sometimes it's because they have a hard time letting go. I've not sensed that in you for one second. You care deeply, and yet I'll never forget even this past leadership team meeting when you said, well, it's not my church. See, you were never building your own kingdom. You were building the kingdom of our King. And our churches are full of men who are actually trying to build their own kingdom. Thank you. Thank you for your commitment to God's word. And thank you for your friendship. I'm looking forward to that continuing. So since we have the opportunity, the privilege to be able to honor both Lester and Artis this morning, I wanted to take a moment and just talk a little bit about honor. The kingdom of God is an honor culture. The culture that we find ourselves in is not an honor culture. The culture in the United States, when you even compare with other countries around the world, lacks honor. But we are called to be men and women who model something different, who truly do honor one another. God exemplifies honor within himself. Think about it. As a Trinitarian God, we see him exemplify it within himself. God the Father, who honors God the Son and God the Spirit. God the Son, who honors God the Father and God the Spirit, and God the Spirit, who honors God the Father and God the Son. It's built within the Trinity itself. Mark chapter 6, 1, it says that Jesus left and he went back to his hometown. It tells this story about how he was preaching, he was traveling, he was going to the synagogues, and he goes back home. And when the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue in his own town, and many heard him and they were amazed. They said things like, where did he get these things? Who is this man? What's this wisdom that he has been given? He even does miracles. That's Mark 6, 1 and 2. But then in 6, 3, someone says, isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't this Mary's son the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Isn't this the ordinary guy? This is what they're saying. Isn't this just the ordinary guy that we grew up with? The guy who, you know, made your kitchen table. Isn't this him? And in verse 4, Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without what? Without honor." The Greek word that is translated without honor is the word atimos. And if you are taking notes, this is what it means. It means to treat someone as common or ordinary. To dishonor is to treat someone as just common and ordinary. If you want maybe a common marriage, then dishonor your husband or wife. There's a correlation. See, the flip side of dishonor is the word honor. And in the Greek, it's the word time. It's spelled T-I-M-E. We could do something with that, but I'm not going to. Time is this idea of having value, to respect, to highly esteem. It means to treat as precious, weighty, and valuable. It's really to ascribe worth. We get this word when Scripture tells us to honor our parents, esteem them, value them. 1 Timothy 5:17 says, "Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching." Romans 12:3-21, though, is where I really want to dwell. So if you want to open your Bibles to that, Romans 12, verses 3-21. It says this, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think." That's kind of a theme that we've been seeing, right, as we go through Philippians. Don't think of yourself more highly. Actually, we see the opposite call, that we are to treat others as if they are more important than us. Not that they are more important, but to treat them as if they are. So Paul is kind of saying the same thing, but in a little different way here. "Think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, to the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness." Basically, his point is, listen, we each have different gifts given to us by God. Let's not elevate one gift over another. Let's not use that as a way to show more honor to somebody. And don't we quickly do that? If we let ourselves, we quickly look at maybe a gifting and honor. That's not the call. The call in the church is to honor each other no matter what. Then it says, "Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor." Listen, this is the only thing that I see that we should be in competition for. Showing honor to one another. Who's going to show more honor, right? Like this is what God's word is saying. Outdo one another in honor. "Do not be slothful in zeal, be fervent in spirit, serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, be constant in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep, live in harmony with one another, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly, never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. There's so much there that we could unpack, but we don't have time for it. What I really want to focus in on, notice that this is called the marks of a true Christian, by the way. What I want to really zero in on is the mention of honor. That we should outdo one another with honor, but then it says, Paul's instruction is that we would do what is honorable in the sight of all. Give honor, but also a responsibility to do what is honorable. I'll just be honest, it's really easy to want to get honor from people and not live honorably. The call is actually the opposite of that, though. The call is, no matter what, to give honor. And I will tell you, a lot of times people are like, well, I'm not going to give honor because they're not living honorably. Actually, the call is to give honor. There's a difference between honor and respect. Respect is earned. Honor is given. There is a difference. And so there's a call. Like, think about it. In chapter 13, it's going to get into the ruling authorities, right? That we are to honor them. No matter what. That's kind of a hard pill to swallow, isn't it? So this is this whole concept. Listen, give honor no matter what. There's many reasons why. One of them is because we've all been made into the image of God. It's the Imago Dei. Every single person, it doesn't matter what culture might say about them, it might not even be what your initial reaction is of somebody, we're still called to honor them because they are the very image of Christ. Big truth. The reason our culture is dishonoring is because people aren't honoring God. All true honor is born out of a heart surrendered to the King of Kings. Psalm 22:23 says, you who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him, revere him, all you descendants of Israel. Oftentimes the problem is we're treating God as common. We are too familiar with him that we start to think that he's just ordinary. We can so quickly treat him just like anyone else. Even in this season where we're celebrating the birth of Christ, it's not about a baby Jesus. Let's not lose the wonder of the fact that he came, that he incarnate, that it's God in the flesh. But at the same point, listen, we don't worship a baby. We worship a risen king. See his glory. He's different. He's altogether other. He is the soon coming, returning, ruling, reigning King of Kings and the Lord of Hosts. And when he comes back, he's coming back with a sword. He is the righteous one, one who shed his blood that we would live. When we don't treat God as common or ordinary, but see him for who he really is, we will honor others because his name is on our hearts. We are not common or ordinary because we're made valuable by his name. And when we get that, we will return to reclaim the forgotten virtue of honor. It's right and it's holy. And so let's continue to be a place, let's continue to be a people who have a culture of honor, not for title, not because we are comfortable around them, not because we really like them, but actually because of who Jesus is. Let's continue to really, really enter into that culture of honor. Let's pray. God, I pray that you would bring this message to our hearts, to a heart level, not just of mine, but that we would be a people even now where we're thinking of how can we honor one another? What are things that we can do, number one, in order to lift high the name of Jesus, to honor him? But then also our brothers and sisters around us. God, may we never be guilty of good intentions only, but to follow through, to write notes, reminders, that we would say the words, that we would give the gift, that we would reach out publicly to honor. But more than just publicly, God, even privately in our hearts, may we have a posture of honor to those around us. God, we thank you in advance for all the opportunities that you are going to give us as a church and individually to give honor where honor is due, out of a reflection for you, of you, for the true honor that we owe you. The honorable King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. Would you stand and sing praises this morning?
Have a good week.